This should update itself.
It should.
You might need to refresh that page.
Okay.
But other than that, if you're just tuning in, we're about to kick off with Jonathan Curran.
Howdy.
Take it away.
Yeah, so I'm Jonathan. I'm here to talk about Bacon.js, but more importantly, not so much the library itself, but more about the principles behind it that are going to be useful. Sorry that there's this dividing thing. I'll try and go back and forth. So, I kind of want to talk to you all about functional reactive programming. And you see I pretty much put that using Bacon is sort of an after effect. It's not really it's that important. But so let's just talk about functional reactive, what that sort of means. The agenda is pretty simple for today. We're going to talk about what functional programming means, compare it to how we normally do things on a regular, everyday basis, imperative style programming. And then we'll just kind of touch on what reactive programming means. And then see what the combination of those two look like using Bacon.js and what that means and how that's useful and why that's useful. In the synopsis I put down that, it kind of helps us manage complex UI interactions. And in my experience so far, that's been, it delivers. It's as best as I can put it. There's a lot less state management I have to do personally. And so anytime I have to do less work, less code, I'm happier. I like deleting stuff. I think in the last year and 4 months or something that I've been at my work, apparently I've deleted 10,000 lines of code. Somebody's counting, so I don't know. Got a badge for it. Okay, you deleted this in line. That's cool. Okay. All right. Imperative programming, I think everyone is familiar with it. Even if you don't know the term, this might be the first time you've seen it. That's okay. Imperative programming is just how we've kind of done programming for the last forever, basically. It's what everybody knows how to do, everybody knows how to do well, everyone learns how to do it better. And basically all your traditional sort of languages are what the imperative style of programming is. Imperative programming basically is when we tell the computer how to solve a particular problem. We do this on a regular, everyday basis. We say, if you want to count, get some of the stuff in a list, we do, hey, go from zero to however big this array is, and then add up all the numbers and do it step by step. Basically, we provide instructions to the computer on how to do things. And we've gotten pretty good at it, dare I say. And we've, with OOP and stuff, we kind of introduced this layers of abstraction and, hiding how actual work is done. And we've done pretty good so far, right? We've built up these abstractions to help us not deal with all the boilerplate things that we normally have to deal with. Functional programming, on the other hand, some examples down there, Haskell, OCaml, ML family of languages, Chuck F-sharp in there. PureScript is this sort of recent one, Clojure a little bit more so. In those languages, we typically specify what needs to be done. We don't specify how it needs to be done. And the reason for that being is because these functional programming languages lend themselves extremely well to building abstractions. Much better so, or let me rephrase that, building reusable abstractions. Much better so than the imperative world allows us. And functional programming is basically a form of declarative programming, and declarative programming is simply, when I think of declarative programming, the first thing that comes to mind is, SQL. Any SQL query language, basically, is a form of declarative programming. For instance, if, an example of this would be, we need to go look up a record from a particular table. Let's say you're doing a login system and you need to find a user with this particular email address, right? In SQL, all you say is, give me this record where the name is this. It figures out how to go access the data. It figures out where that data is. It figures out all these things, and then just gives you that record, right? We don't normally have to write, do a table scan, figure out if there's an index, then use the index, then do this, then do that. That entire layer has been abstracted for us through this query language. And that's very beneficial because it allows a lot of people to do a lot of work really quickly. Writing all those things by hand gets a bit tedious. Quick little example of that is back in the day when MongoDB sort of first came out, and you need to do any sort of aggregate queries, you literally had to write all the stuff out yourself, if anybody remembers. You had to say, you know, gather this thing into this record, and here's this little function that's going to run on top of every record, and then do your aggregate stuff in that little function. And it would call you, you would do all your stuff yourself for all the records in that query, basically. That's sort of a mix of imperative, because you have to handle that, and functional in terms of they have a query language, but hey, you get to plug in stuff and do whatever you need to. And most importantly, functional programming, they use function composition to solve problems. All that means is you have one function, you have another function, it just takes some data here, passes it here. Nothing more complicated than that. I stole this slide off of MSDN, which is a good, bad, great resource, depending on who you talk to. Sort of highlights what the differences sort of between imperative and functional programs are. The stuff that I'm mostly interested in, and I think you'll probably primarily be more interested in, is the programmer focus. And you know how I mentioned before, imperative, you tell how, functionally you say what. And sort of related to that is the primary manipulation units. Basically, how do we access data? How do we move it around? In imperative style, we end up building, you know, structures, classes. We just chuck information into one class. We access it in another class. We hope nobody messes with one thing here. Otherwise, stuff over here breaks. That's just sort of how we have to deal with it. In the functional approach, everything passes inside functions or via functions. There is no class here or struct there. It's just data goes into this function, gets passed right very next to the very next function. There's no intermediary global state that you have to manage yourself based on. So the way you approach this in thinking also is very difficult, especially when you're starting off with it. It can take some time. But there are many advantages. We'll see with the examples that were. I just want to take a quick little survey. Is folks familiar with functional programming here? There, okay, so about a little less than half the room. So in functional programming, there's sort of the big four functions, I like to call them, the big four functional functions. And these big four, the reason I say they're this important is because almost every other function is built on top of these ones or a combination of these four. And just kind of having an understanding of this is really useful. And some of y'all might already use this on a daily basis and not even think about it. So there's that added benefit. The first one is compose. And you know, as I mentioned, function composition is literally just taking two functions and making one call the other one. That's all it is. It's nothing more than that. Down here, we're saying, hey, we call this inner function with this parameter, and then call the outer function with the result of that, right? It's nothing too fancy. And the order of composition does matter, as you see down here. You know, which order you compose a function is does make a bit of a difference. So nothing too fancy about this, right? It's just a function that takes two functions and returns a third function, which takes a parameter and then just invokes those two functions that you pass it. Normally with JavaScript programming, I've never really seen this out in the wild too much. If you work with functional programmers, then you would probably see an instance or two of this kind of stuff. But not directly. The other one is map. I reckon probably a lot of people have used the map function on, say, an array list or some other data structure in JavaScript. What map does is literally just takes a set of inputs and takes a function to do manipulation on each one of those inputs and just returns, you know, whatever it needs to be done. So in this case, the function over here, we're just doubling the numbers. We pass it this over here, this array, and just outputs the doubled numbers here. Filter is more or less the same, except with a invariant condition there. The invariant over here is just, you know, hey, I want to make sure this thing's divided by, or modulo 2 is equal to 0. And it just filters all the ones that are modulo 0, or modulo 2, into this list over here. Nothing too fancy, it's just excluding certain items from a set or a list, whatever it is, right? And these examples here are just operating on arrays, just for simplicity's sake. They can operate on other things. One thing I guess I should mention so far, and I haven't said this before, apologize for that, is that functional programming, in the sort of traditional sense, if you think about it, a function is what? It just takes an input and has an output. It doesn't change the input. It does something in between, and then gives you a new output. So in functional programming, you never modify your inputs. As you'll see here, I've never operated on the list itself. We build a new one, and then we attach data to it. Then we return the new data. The neat thing about this is you can call multiple functions in the list, or you know, however you need to, and be sure that you're not messing with the original input. It makes debugging that much easier, because you know each step can only do one particular thing. Testing becomes a lot easier as well. You don't have to manage global state, you don't have to do mocks, you don't have to do a whole bunch of other stuff. You just kind of say, hey, blah, do this, and you know exactly what it's going to do. Added benefit. The other one's called fold. Fold, what it does, you can read this. I didn't understand the first few times I looked at it. I was like, how does this work? But in a nutshell, it literally takes the first, it takes a sequence of elements, like first pairs, if you will, and then does some function on them. But it takes an initial data point, in which to match the first item in the list with. So for instance, if we pass this list a fold, it'll take 0, pass into A, it'll take 1, pass into B. And it'll just return, you know, just a 1 over here. The next time it calls it, there'll be a 1 in the A position and a 2 in the B position. It just kind of goes down that list and does some work on it. Right? So in this thing, we're basically combining the items that are in that list and squishing it down to 1. Another word for fold is called reduce. You've probably seen it somewhere if you're doing some sort of JavaScript stuff. Everybody good on that? Cool. Fun bit, I'll just mention it. You can implement map and filter in terms of fold. It's just a fun exercise to do, and you'll see your brain expand. That's all. All right, just want to check this out here. I'll give you a 10 seconds to figure out what that does.
Authors in the keynote. All
right, what's that?
The list of authors and their unique emails.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, it gets the author's email basically from some commit message, apparently in some data structure. It's kind of all it does. And then it outputs it here and this JSON and this stringify. This is normally how we write code. It's not pretty to look at. It's not fun to work, but that's normally how we do things. Right? We have a set of instructions. We say, hey, go do this. And we have to specify to the computer what to do. Like, this is how you need to do this. Compare this with the functional approach. I'll just use plain old JavaScript here, ES5 stuff. That's a lot easier to read to me. And I reckon it probably is a lot easier to read for most of y'all as well. It's just a lot cleaner. You know, we've got this mapping function. We just say get the email, we sort it, then we get the unique ones, we filter out stuff that's already in the list, and then we just output it. Nothing fancy. It's just, this is much easier to read than that. One thing, though, about this particular thing is that it's not quite so functional. And the reason I say it's not quite so functional is only simply because of this line right here, emails.sort. It operates on the list itself, using whatever the default sorting is. Not that big a deal. A cleaner, sort of nicer way to kind of do this. You're wondering, how can you make this nicer? Good question. It's simply this. R, capital R here, is a library called Ramda, and it's probably the best functional library out in JavaScript land, and I'd recommend looking at it. But anyway, all you have to do is basically construct a pipeline, if you will, of work that needs to be done. In this pipeline, we say, run this mapper, then do the sort based on this comparison, provide some unique stuff, and then finally just stringify it. Right, we construct this data pipeline, if you will. We shove stuff in here, we get stuff out. It's basically a giant function composed of many other functions in there. And this little thing, you can just shake it, chuck it somewhere else, and reuse it. Not a big deal. The more important part is we're using the bits that are inside here. Right? It's not tied to any particular data structure over here. You know, it's not tied to this unique emails or anything that we have to read. It's just, it doesn't care what it is. All it just does is map over this stuff. We don't have to deal with extra, you know, variable names, things for us to mentally, cognitively think about. And, you know, I kind of prefer not having to think. So, especially when I don't have to. All right. So I mentioned Ramda is a really good functional library. The other one out there for which is called Functional.js. And I put these, even though they're very popular, the first two today, in the not-so-functional library category. And if you want the reason for that, I'd recommend taking a look at this YouTube link or this video that's out there called Hey Underscore, You're Doing It Wrong. The gist of it boils down to function composition. You cannot compose functions easily in underscore or lower dash. That's basically it. That being said, I'm just going to skip over this because it's not that important. All right, had enough of functional stuff. Reactive programming, what is that? According to this little dictionary, it's just responding to stimulus. What does that mean? When you resize your browser, what happens? Stuff happens. You don't know what exactly happens, just stuff happens, right? When you click on a button, stuff happens. When you enter some text, something happens. Events get fired. The DOM reacts, calls your function, and then you do things inside of it. That's basically what reactive programming is. You're reacting to something. Nothing too complicated. People tell you otherwise, yeah, I don't know. I wouldn't trust them so much. The core concept in reactive programming is that there's a supposed to be a data type that has values over time. That is a sort of a mind-bending concept, because typically, you know, when we have a variable somewhere, we set it to something. Later down, the user does something, and then we go change it, right? There's no particular way to, say, hook up the user input to the variable directly and have all the variables changes propagate to whoever's listening to it. At least not yet. We wait for, what is it, object.observe. Hopefully it will come out. Who knows? Apparently it's only in Chrome right now. So if that happens, then you can do some neat things like, hey, I'm going to change the variable up here, but all its little subscribers down here, they'll all get changed in turn as well. So that'll be neat when it comes out. But that's basically reactive programming. You're responding to events that happen. Sorry, can I get a glass of water or something? If you had the notion of, you know, data binding, observables, event propagation, all this, et cetera, you'd be thinking in the absolute correct way. That's all reactive programming is. So, or even signals, if you want to use the, you know, signals.js or whatever, and think about it in that sense, it's more or less the same thing. Some event happens, you subscribe to that event, other things happen down the chain. Right? So far, though, in sort of the imperative land, where we've stopped is at the DOM event level. We listen to some changes that happen to DOM, and we do stuff from there, that point on. We don't propagate that event flow downstream. We usually stop right there, and we try to manage everything ourselves. Sort of more or less agreed on that? Right? And it becomes a pain when you're doing bigger applications. Not so much when you're doing a smaller one, but an example to show you that you might think so otherwise. Yeah, so basically what we'd like to do is propagate changes that happen anywhere further downstream, right? But JavaScript doesn't quite have a data type that represents a value over time. At least not natively, but we can sort of emulate it with the function. If you call a function repeatedly, in the functional sense, it should give you the same value over and again for the same input in the functional land, right? And the reactive type thing has no concept of that. Reactive, it's like, I don't care. I have some value that goes over time. It doesn't matter what it is. If, however, we were to hook up the functional stuff into the reactive stuff just by itself, nothing would work, right? Because we have the same function, the same inputs, or the same output, nothing changes, nothing quite works, right? So how do we, what manages the state in order to let these changes propagate, right? And that's where sort of Bacon.js and Rx.js and the entire Rx family of libraries sort of come into play. They allow you to sort of functionally compose functions that you provide or they have into this sort of this reactive data type, if you will, that represents a series of values over time as time progresses, and allows sort of events to plug into that chain, or that pipeline, or that flow, if you will. So quite a bit of different thinking, but it pays off. So functional reactive programming, what Bacon and Rx do, what they're concerned with is modeling state over time. How do we capture user input? How do we feed it to these theoretical, like these pipelines of functions, if you will, and how does work get done? That's what those two sort of libraries are concerned with. And they use a lot of the functional programming things to make not only our lives easier, but their lives easier as well. Because the nice thing with functions is, just functional functions, is that you can just lift them and use them anywhere. There's no state, there's no nothing, it's just self-contained, which is great for library authors and end users as well. All right. Let's put this up here. So Bacon has this notion of an observable. An observable has a couple of things, actually. It's got two types in there. One's an event stream. This is where sources of events come from. So for instance, this could be a user's typing. This could be an input, mouse input, clicks. This could actually be other event streams producing other data that another event stream could listen for too as well. And event streams can be combined, can be mapped, can be filtered. They can do some time-based things like delayed or throttled or what's everyone's favorite one? The debounce, basically. You have to deal with repeated data, but you don't want to do too quickly. And so event streams is just that. It's the stream of events. There can be more than one or more events in a particular stream. The more part comes in when you're aggregating things. So for instance, a mouse click here and an input there, or something, or the mouse is in one particular funny direction. You want to capture, say, a series of events from that mouse. Could be something like that. Sorry. Our property is, I've got this, it's a function. These two are both functions underneath the hood, basically. Actually, most JavaScripts have most stuff is just functions, but we don't normally look at it that way. It's just a reactive property. All that means is you subscribe to it somehow, and anytime it changes, it calls you. Right? So it's sort of an event handler. And event stream does the same way. You can plug into both of these and do that. The property has a notion of what's my value now? This could be when the page loads up, or when your app starts up in the back end. Doesn't matter. It just has a concept of what's my value right now. Event streams don't have that. Event streams are lazy, right? The user goes does something, only then will it have some value in it. Whereas a property, you can say, start with this value. That's more or less the only difference between those two. So event streams and properties, like I mentioned, can be operated on. You can do math functional stuff on them. And you can convert between both types. The nice thing about Bacon, I find, is that there's only these two types. If you look in RxLand, there's hot observables, there's cold observables, there's some other funny things. I just find the naming to be much better in this. And more or less, event streams and properties have a one-way data flow. This is what differentiates them via versus, say, signals, for instance. Or at least our normal understanding of signals-based libraries in JavaScript. When you can't push stuff into these things, you cannot take an event stream and say, hey, here's a new value. You can't do that. Because that's initiated by a user's input or some external input. You can't do that with a property either. So that's sort of a one-way data flow. I put an asterisk there simply because there's a third type here called a bus. And with a bus, you can't stuff things on top of it. But I'm not going to cover it here because you probably shouldn't use it unless you absolutely have to. So let's not cover that. All right. to the code. I think talking about this is one thing. Looking at what works, what doesn't work, is another thing. So let's just fire something up. And our little example, what we'll do is we'll just kind of cover a login form, if you will. Nothing fancy, but I could ask you all to read this and figure out what it does. It'll take 10 seconds to do that. Actually, I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. Don't look at this. Look at this. this is a basic login form. I'm just using jQuery here, just because I just want to show we sort of normally do stuff, nothing complicated. Basically, all the login form does with all this stuff down here is basically do some error handling. That's about it. All it does is if we have validated in all these three fields and that one's checked, then it'll enable the register button. That's all it's going to do, right? You'll notice we have to keep track of all our little state here. And then we have to operate. And when that state happens, then we do some stuff, basically. Right? And this thing needs to be called everywhere changes happen here. And it needs to be explicit. So validate form gets called on the email blur event. Right? So we do this, and we make sure is it valid. If it's not valid, then we set some error text. And then we call validate form, because if we didn't do that, none of the state stuff would be updated, and the button wouldn't get enabled or disabled. Nothing too fancy. We basically do the same thing for these two as well. Here we just check the password, make sure it matches, make sure it has proper length. Nothing too fancy, right? But we have to keep track of all the state ourselves. We can't just tell the computer, hey, go do this. We have to specify what to do, how to, and more importantly, how to do it. We have to present the steps to the computer on how we're doing things. So just to give you an example if it works. Great. That button doesn't work, right? That works. That works. Apparently, if you use the HTML5 input validator for type email, that is a valid email address. Without a TLD, but with a TLD, you know, email addresses usually need TLDs for not local host communications, but apparently that's valid for some reason. So you might be thinking, Jonathan, why would you write validation code in this day and age anyway? Well, here's a tiny reason why. That's all. So, you know, now the button's enabled. That's basically it. We toggle this, that goes off. Nothing too fancy. I just want to ask Alexis, how are we doing for time?
You're good.
I don't want to go too long because I know it's already late. So.
No, it's not late at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm gonna ask y'all because it's really up to y'all. How would you like me to approach the actual code? Do you want me to just show you a working example and talk you through it, or do you want me to implement this entire thing step by step? Show you an example.
Implement it.
Will my name be quicker? It will be, but we won't get to talk through all the things.
Maybe you could briefly show the example.
Sure.
And then proceed to show how you implement it.
Okay. Well, the nice thing is I've already implemented it, right? I'm not doing this live. I don't fly like that. Yeah. This is sort of the functional part. The scroll bar doesn't need to register, more or less. This one, there's a chunk of code there. So I'm just talking about, right now, it's just very simple. Like, that's a big selling point. Less code, is it readable? That's the bigger question, right? Quickly, sort of. We sort of set up event streams from the sources, the targets, this basically. So for instance, our regular jQuery thingy over here, we plugged in an as event stream on the blur event, and then we do this work down here. Same thing with password, and the second password, and then we've got this comparison thing which does some stuff, and this equals thing that does some stuff. Basically, stuff that does stuff. No, just kidding. There's a source here, and there's a source here as well. And looking at just this first part, can you all sort of figure out what might happen? Is that understandable? Right over here, we do a regular jQuery thing. We get the event stream. We're saying, hey, get the target.value of the event. Right, get that particular value out of it. And then what we're going to do is we're going to test it with this regex. We're going to say, hey, does it match that regular expression? Yes or no? And so over here in this map function, what do you suppose the type is? In the map over here? The type of return, sorry.
It's a Boolean.
Yeah, it's a Boolean, right? We're just calling the regex test stuff, that's all. And so we're taking this event stream, we're converting it to a property. No, it doesn't matter so much right now. But converting to a property that can have a value currently, right? It's not a source of events anymore. It just has a value currently. And we'll assign it to this CSS selector, and we'll toggle its hidden class. All right, and so when I go to... I do some stuff there, you'll see that first part works, right? Over here, we're doing the same thing. For the password thing, we're saying, hey, get the event stream, and then get the target value out of it. And same thing for the password too. That's all we're doing, right? We're just hooking up some stuff there. The important part is down here, where we're creating this little variable called password equals, and we're saying, hey, Bacon, combine these two streams with this function, the values that those two streams produce, we will then do this comparison to them. And then, therefore, this pass equals variable over here will be an event stream of whether these two streams, the values in them, are equal. Right? So this is a source of equality for the elements in these two fields right here. And that's created as an event stream. We take that event stream, and over here you see this on value. It's more or less the same thing as assign over here. Just a little different semantics. Doesn't matter too much, whichever one you want to use. But we're basically saying, get that CSS selector, and then toggle its hidden thing on there. Right, so we take that equality stream, and we just plug it into on value, call this function. Over here we did the same thing, except you don't see the V parameter over here. It's sort of, that's a Bacon.js sort of nicety function, if you will. If you write stuff this way, it'll just chuck the last parameter and call that function, basically. Everyone good with me so far on this equal stuff? Anyone not so good on it? Because that's important, too. It's actually very important if you're not good on that. Cool. So, this part, email simple, password simple. And that's just the equality check, right? And what we'll do for the length one is we'll just check the second one, because it's not particularly important that we check both of them, because we already have an equality one here, right? So we'll just say, hey, does the length, is it greater than 5? And so this password length thing, event stream, well, this will be an event stream of whether the length in that, in password 2 over here, is greater than 5. So this is saying, hey, go run this function. You're now an event stream of Boolean values. Yes or no? And we'll do this sort of the same thing as we did with the other two. We'll just take that. We'll say, hey, whenever you get a value, call this function. That's already three state things we didn't have to manage. Right? You don't have to have a variable somewhere and go edit it here and go do that. Nothing that we have to write ourselves. And we don't have to make sure we call this, the valid screen. This validate form method, we don't have to call that everywhere that we want change to occur. We just sort of intrinsically hook up what we want the behavior to be. And that's sort of what FRP sort of brings to the table, is and we can declare what the behavior is supposed to be. We don't have to tell it what to do, how to do it. You say, hey, I want this to be this way. These are the end goals. Do stuff in between. Hook it up. I just want the end goal. That's the important part. All right, so the terms being checked for that little checkbox, basically the same thing. We get the event stream for the click, and let me just do a jQuery comparison, or we call a little is function on it with the selector. Yeah, is a type box checked? And so this is term checked is going to be an event source of booleans. Right? Yes or no? This thing doesn't have an error value on it because it doesn't. That's just the way it is. And so what we do is, you know, we'll combine these valid email, password length, password equality, and terms checked. We'll combine these streams together with this function over here. And all we're doing is calling an AND on all of them. If all these things are true, then stuff should happen. And so what we're saying down here is, if this stuff is true, convert it to a property, and start with false. And start with has importance here, because when we load our page, the property down here, if we just ended at this line, wouldn't have any value in it, because no streams have been triggered yet, right? No user input has occurred. But we want that to be sort of preloaded with some data. And so we just preload it with the false value. And then we'll invert it, because that's how the jQuery attribute disabled thing works, because we have to flip it, basically. And then we do a not over here. And then we just basically get to call them enabling and disabling the, calling the attribute for enabled or for disabled, rather. So we'll just kind of do that. Passwords don't match, blah, blah, blah. And then we'll just toggle that. Hey, it works. Right? So, sorry. So can you all sort of see how this is a bit more declarative than sort of the imperial style of doing the same validation, right? This is a very simple form. It's four fields, right? Nothing magical about it. But if you can imagine a UI scenario where, you know, you have lots of dependent things, and this curve, right? If you're doing some sort of admin sort of dashboard, if you're doing some sort of search results, you know, filtering, query building, if you will, stuff gets pretty hairy pretty quickly, especially when you have to manage lots and lots of state. Using this declarative sort of format, you specify the behavior of how things are related, and then what you want to happen when things happen. That's the end point, basically. That's the last thing you have to worry about. And more or less, that's the important part, right? The state management is not important. It is if you're doing imperative stuff. But more importantly is the behavior. What happens when the user does these things? What happens when I do these things? What is supposed to happen? Do you care about how it happens? Does the user care about how you manage state? I highly doubt that, right? The user's not going to look at your JavaScript code and be like, oh, I don't like the way this guy wrote this code. Users aren't going to do that. They're not going to care. As long as some buttons work for them, that's all they're going to care about. And that's important to them. And that's what should be important to us. And because of that, to make our lives easier, we should do everything we can to make our lives easier. Don't switch this overnight. That's not what I'm saying. This is here to sort of give you a different take on how to think, basically, how to approach problem solving. That's all it is. I do imperative stuff for a day job. I work with Python stuff. And it's got a bit of functional stuff in it, but not too much. So I do that for a living. I do this on the side, which hopefully will be a living soon. So.
I have a question.
Yes.
So I see that you have the error that I guess from what I just maybe this is B2B, but the error because it seems like a class and then you have other things that's underneath it.
Which part is
like the length, the
this controls, one.
Right.
Yeah.
Is it P always P?
Doesn't have to
be like B dot error.
So let's just take a look at the source, shall we? This is just the source of the thing. The way I've structured it is that I have a P class over here.
Oh, I see.
That's just the way I've structured it. And the CSS selector that I've used is sort of, it's basically sort of the, where'd it go? Yeah, I can't barely read this. Where'd it go? Right here. Yeah, yeah. So that's sort of the sibling selector. It's like, hey, whatever's next to you, give me that thing.
You're just changing the class for that.
Yes, I'm just toggling that hidden class. Element. Yes, you'll see over here it's hidden, so we just toggle that on or off.
Right.
The hidden is just displayed on, okay. I think, somewhere. Yeah. Sorry, anybody else had a question? So yeah, nothing too fancy. It's just we hook up behavior. That's how we do it. So that's one example. All right, second example. We actually want to make that register button do some work. It'd be kind of silly if we didn't do anything. Let me just double check this. Basically the same code here. Sorry. All right. So this I need to show the console for. It's because stuff is going to happen in the console. Should just see minimally what it does. So over here we want to make that register button do some work, right? And so you see right now it's still disabled. Let's just go into some data. This button, it's going to make some calls out here. It's going to take 3 seconds, and it's going to be, it will receive some JavaScript object, which doesn't make any difference whatsoever what that is, but the important thing to know is it does a remote call and gets some data. That's the important part right here. So how do we do that in the register thing, right? The first sort of thing we do is, well, this part is down here, but it's not that important. What we basically want to do is we want to take the register button, get the click event stream off of it, right? That's the important part, because we want to do some action when that happens. And then sort of somehow hook that up to something that does our XHR for us. We're just going to call jQuery's AJAX stuff in there. Okay? So the initial part is very simple. When we get a click event, we should do something. That's what we want, right? Not too difficult. So our submit enabled function is the same from last time. And what we'll do over here is when the submit button gets clicked, we'll call the prevent default on it. Nothing too fancy. In Bacon, you can call a doAction function, which just performs something for you that doesn't have any return value. For instance, it's not map, because map would, that there's nothing. It returns undefined, right? Or if you call prevent default, it doesn't return a true or false. Just does nothing. It's like sort of a, doesn't have a return value. And so once that submit button's clicked, what we'll do is we'll take that, we'll call this flat map function. I'll go into it in just a second. So when the submit button gets clicked, we'll call this jQuery AJAX thing, right? And we'll do some work inside of it. We'll just fire that off and do stuff. And we'll skip this part over here. When we get some data, then we'll just put it received. If we get an error, we'll say, oops, that failed, sorry. Right. So this part over here and this part over here, that's sort of where our actions occur. Right. This still sort of looks like regular things we do in our normal day, everyday basis anyway, right? Not too bad. All right, so what flat map over here does is, as you'll note, in our submit click thing, that's an event stream of itself, right? That is an event stream where click events sort of get sent through. What we'd like to happen, though, is we want to kick off an AJAX request when this click happens. If we just try to do math over here, what we'd end up getting is, let's take this from promise out. Don't worry about that for now. But if we just did a math over here, what math would return is when I get a click, then I'm going to return an AJAX event. Unfortunately, that AJAX event won't play with Bacon anymore, because that AJAX event is not a Bacon-y type of stream. It's not an event. It's not a property. It's something Bacon doesn't know about, right? So we have to sort of wrap that in something. And so we wrap that in is a promise. you know, the jQuery's Ajax returns a deferred, if you will, but it's basically a promise. And so we'll say, hey, Bacon, go ahead and convert whatever you're about to get into a promise so that we can call functions on it down here. However, what that would do is we would have a click event, and then it would generate an event. It would generate an event stream, because that from promise generates an event stream. So we have an event stream producing an event stream. We can't quite listen on when the original event stream has a value anymore, because the value it'll have is an event stream, which is just, it's like you're building layers of event streams. That's not what we want. We just want one event stream where stuff happens. Right? So if you can imagine, the click event stream is up here, and this event stream over here, if this was didn't have FlatFab in here, this would be a second event stream. What we want is to make them into the same one. So what FlatMap does is exactly that. It creates, says, hey, if there's any stuff that gets produced that is also an event stream, I'm just going to stick it back in this original, because that's what you care about. So once we do that, then we can actually, this part down here, the on value and on error stuff works. Because otherwise, it would provide, give you some weird errors. We can see that in a minute. So this sort of looks normal. It's OK. And then what we're going to do over here is we have a little spinny thing. And the spinny thing should show up down here, right? When that happens, the Ajax is running somewhere. We want the little spinner to show up. Normally, in just using jQuery, there's like a handler, a special handler you can sort of invoke and give it and say, hey, when I'm running, then call my handler. And when you're done, call my handler again. And you kind of have to manage the state in that yourself, right? So now you're sort of coupled to another library's how it handles stuff as well. And you have to know about it. And new people that come on your project, they have to know about it as well. Has anyone implemented a global Ajax handler, like a little spinny thing? Or an app anywhere? How easy was that?
Easy.
Like, do you have like per component where it shows up, or is it just sort of in the page? All over the page.
Usually just like I've done a thing like you did where it's
just shows up
in the right next to the button and right. The button grays out and it's on top of it.
Yeah.
In a field just be able to wait for the value to come.
Yeah, so that's how normally I'm like, it's not that big a deal, right? It's not that big a deal. If you were at our project about 9 months ago, I think, they were our entire app is based in Angular. It's a huge app. What they wanted was, they wanted an Ajax spinner per component that the user had to see and deal with. So global Ajax isn't going to work. And every time we, basically there's a big hoo-ha about how do we do this properly in order to be reusable and in order for people to understand this. It took way too long to do because it was like, how do we reuse this piece of code? But hey, we can't reuse it because none of the components are alike. They don't all look the same. So therefore, crap, we can't really do this that easily. So they basically didn't take that handler and put it in a component and wrap that. They put it in some global thing that just listens everywhere. Because that's the easiest thing to do. Anyway, getting sidetracked, sorry. So the way you sort of do that, remember I mentioned that event streams can be hooked up to other event streams? That's basically what we'll do. We'll say, hey, when that submit is clicked, it's going to be waiting on this register request. When that happens, or rather, is it waiting on this other event? That's all we're saying. Is that the submit gets clicked, produces a thing, is it now waiting on the result for this guy over here? That's just going to be a property yes or no, basically. And what we'll want to do over here, just for something you'll figure out, is we just want to map any errors that happen to false. And I'll show an example of the error right now. And we'll flip it and we'll assign it to the toggle class. Right? Nothing too complicated. It's just the same sort of stuff we did in the previous one where we toggle the error handling or the error message. That's all it is. So a stream can be waiting on another one. That's the gist of that. Is that, anyone have any questions about that? All right. So we're hooking up two streams. We're saying, hey, your result is dependent on whether this thing is alive or not. you have a true or you're false, and that's kind of about it. Right? So that's another way to sort of combine and deal with fields. All right. When I first started doing Bacon, FRP, if you will, that's how I wrote my code. I put everything inside term promise and do my stuff, go get events from the DOM and whatnot. More and more I dealt with it, the more and more I was confused because I'm like, well, the rest of the app is sort of in a declarative sense. Why then am I doing everything, you know, imperatively over here? Yeah, it's not that big a deal. You know, I'm accessing some DOM elements, getting their value out of it. But I'm like, you know, there are events up there. Can I plug those events into this somehow? That was my sort of big question. And turns out, yes, you can. And it makes out for slightly better code. First, I'm going to show you the little error example I said. So just change that to return error message. First stage. Show you that it works. Hey, spinners, go spin. And that 400 throws an error, and it's like, oh, oops, sorry, here's your error. That's all I wanted to show you. Whether there's a successful message or a successful response or an error response, you can handle both via, you know, on valley and on error. That's all that is. These two guys down here, basically. All right. You'll see over here that I reworked some of this. Just the old one, and this is the new one, right? So there are some changes in here. The changes what I did was I just pulled these DOM selectors up into their own thing, and then I kind of created, I basically forked off of that and created some other stuff down here. So nothing that's changing. I just called email to email stream. The output is true falses, and we'll assign it like we did previously. Passwords, the same thing. We kind of kept that. We didn't change any of that. Term stream, same thing. And yep, same attribute stuff that we're doing. Hey, what do you know? This part's new. See this combined template over here? The method that Bacon's got and RxJS has as well. If you'll notice over here on the right-hand side of these values, we plugged in event streams into these, into the value locations, if you will, of these keys, right? So this combined template takes an object, and we kind of create this object. And we have event streams on the right-hand side over here that we're plugging into there. Now you might be wondering, what the hell, right? Because we're producing this object, which has event streams inside of it. What use is that? Well, the good use is it helps us kind of write stuff a bit more declaratively. Because you don't want to think about too much about how things actually happen. You know, you don't want to go fetch the particular DOM stream, DOM values, if you will, in code that you don't have to have. Right? There's no reason for that. So what we'll then do is we'll take this combined template. What combined template does is anytime there's a value that gets produced in any of the event streams that it has inside of process, it produces a new object entirely. But only when all the events it has have been satisfied, if you will, right? So it's sort of like your combined with over here. When all these four have some value, only then will that function get called. Same sort of thing over here. So you can imagine user goes types all this stuff and you know, once they finally have all the stuff in here, that will produce an object with this data inside of it. And what we do here is combine that template, combine the object that's produced. We say it's sampled by the submit click event. What sampled by does is it says, if this stream that I'm being passed has some event in it, only then will I take stuff from this other one. Right? Because that's important. If we just had this combined template over here, we didn't have any of this other stuff, it would keep firing events anytime there was values in these guys. And we don't want that, right? As the user is typing, we don't want this object to get created because what's the point? There's no point to it. So we'll say only when the submit button's clicked and you have stuff, then only do the rest. And the rest is the same thing as the flat map from the previous slide. And then we just call the AJAX request over here. Big difference here between this one and the previous slide is just we don't use DOM selectors in here. That's all it is. And that kind of helps us kind of keep our abstractions a bit further. We don't have to plug things in all over the code base. We can only kind of declare them once up here, and the rest down here is just how does everything fit together. The less we spread state around, the easier it is for folks to maintain code and to do things with it later, especially refactoring things. I can't say I've still found a good JavaScript refactoring tool, library, utility, IDE. Like, they all work to some limited capacity, but JavaScript not being typed is not conducive to going and doing big refactorings. And so I have to do a lot of tests. Same as Python. All right. So I'm going to reckon this works. Right? I'm just asking, do you guys think this works? I don't know. Let's see. Hey, look, some events going out there. Cool. Don't know what all that is. Got sent. Let's see. We're expecting the emails to get sent and the password to get sent, right? But what got sent was all this stuff. Email, description, context, like, what the heck is that? It basically means I didn't do this right. Down here, I was noticing I've got this email stream down here, right? Set up. And the stream down here. The streams up here, they end when I map over something. So that's supposed to be a true or false. It's not actually the value contained in the email. What I'd have to do for that is chop it over here. That becomes one stream. And then take that one stream and plug it into this guy and create two streams. One stream for the source of the value in the input, and the other stream for the source of whether the value input matches the regular expression or not. So we have two streams. And then we listen to the first one. Anyway, I want to show you one other cool thing. Cool as in it'll save you a lot of time and frustration. So let's go change this to, you know, take 5 seconds, if you will. Anyone ever implemented anything related to, the example I'm going to use here is this spinner, right? AJAX is in request. Is in flight, if you will, sorry. And you know, your requirements are, hey, we need to show a spinner only if it's been, a request takes more than like 500 milliseconds. It's a normal request, right? Anyone done that before? All right. Well, how easy is that to do, to work with timeouts and things?
It's relatively easy as long as you remember state and have it flow very well defined.
Yes. That's the important part. Again, it's all about remembering state in our application. The less I have to do that, the easier it is for me. One of the nice things is there are a lot of time-based functions that come built in with Bacon. So the neat thing is you can say, you know, delay the stream for, yeah, let's just make it a second, if you will. Delay it for a second. If something happens within a second, don't even bother doing this. Only if it takes longer than a second, then go do stuff. That's pretty useful to have. So, check this guy. Well, that's not doing what I wanted to do, is it?
Did you refresh the page?
Maybe I didn't. Maybe I did. Let's see. Yeah.
Nope. My bad. I had that working. Oh, sorry, this is not the right page. That's 03. This is 0. That'll do it. Nope, yep. Right, so some niceties to sort of help us manage that. We push that again just in case. Nothing, and then after a second it shows up. Then it kind of continues doing things. So that's one of the smaller sort of functional helpers, if you will. One thing I haven't mentioned yet is at each invocation on the event stream, Bacon actually creates a new event stream. So for instance, over here, when we create this as event stream over here, that's one. When we call the map, that's the second one. And you might be thinking, okay, if this guy produces three of them, because you know this first one's one, the second one's two, this one's three. Right? It's like, hey, if I'm creating these event streams all over the place, isn't my app getting slow? Like, isn't just the waste of resources and things like that? Well, the nice part is no, because we have garbage collection. Yeah, that's one reason. The second reason is that all streams in Bacon are lazy by default. What that means is if there's no subscribers, nothing's going to happen. If there's no pipeline coming through, there's no data coming through, nothing's going to happen. Only until both of those are sort of active, only then do things get created, and then things kind of go flow down the pipeline, if you will. So I'm kind of neat for that. There are a lot of other helpers in Bacon for doing lots of async and managing, you know, how many requests kind of go out at the same time. So, if, you know, if you're doing an aggregate search API or something like that, and you want to say, hey, our search provider only allows us to call 5 queries a second per, you know, end client thing. There's a really, like, awesome little function in here that Bacon provides. I don't know where it is. Sorry, but basically, you can do stuff as in, say, fire off these streams with concurrency limit, as in, I'm going to feed you a whole bunch of work, but then you manage all the, it's called flat map with concurrency limit. Let's say to Bacon, hey, I'm going to create all these AJAX requests. I'm going to try to, but you manage when they're in flight, and you limit them to 5 a second or whatever your requirements are. This kind of stuff is not particularly easy to deal with. I mean, there are libraries that people have built, but it's not particularly, you know, something that comes built with any particular standard framework to do with. And this is one of the reasons I like Bacon, because there's a lot of reusable primitives that are here, and a lot of them you wouldn't even think, it's like, oh, that's pretty useful for me to use. Like this combined template thing, I only learned about that after I got frustrated with the jQuery one after a while. So I'm like, man, I don't have to go get all my DOM stuff and do all of it myself. Like, I already have a notion of that somewhere. Why can't I just reuse it? So I went looking, and then I found it. I was like, awesome. This helps me a bit. There's a lot of other stuff in here. I will say that in my experience, it's been that the Bacon stuff has been a bit better documented than the RxJS version. In the RxJS world is sort of point and say, hey, go look at the Rx Java documentation. And I'm like, fast. Because documentation is really important to me. I don't want to read another language's documentation and try to convert whatever that is into the other language stuff. It just doesn't quite map too well in my head. That's sort of where I sort of see Bacon sort of doing a little bit better. The API documentation is pretty good. It definitely could be better, and there definitely could be more examples. Anytime you need help, just ask GitHelp stuff. That's basically how I can do stuff. Let's see where this goes. I'll put this slide deck on the meetup page. I'll just put a link to it. You guys can kind of go take a look at it. The first one, that guy has his own little framework called, what's that, Mercury? Something like that? Recycle, cycle.js. That's what he has. His entire thing is taking RxJS, combining it with React and a couple other things, and trying to do stuff in that sort of way. It's a little too far off in the deep end for me, because I haven't dealt with that stuff yet. But if that's something you're interested in, I'd first check out the article, then check out his GitHub repo, and then check out a couple things. That article right there is probably one of the better articles I found that to an introduction of what it means to do functional reactive. It uses RxJS as an example, but from what you've just sort of seen here today, I'm sure it's not going to be any different. The second one, it's a good explanation on functional reactive, and it's actually not the accepted answer in Stack Overflow. The accepted answer on Stack Overflow is a fully academic dump of what functional reactive programming is, which doesn't help me too much. The second answer, however, is quite neat. It actually gives you a good example of what FRP looks like. And I personally, the way I learn is when I look at examples, I see them working. That's kind of how I understand things instead of just reading things. So that helped me quite a bit, a lot over there. The other one was just the API. That's sort of all I had. What was I going to mention? If it comes to me, I'll think about it. Does anyone have any questions for me? Brad?
I think you bug it.
That's a good question. So, let me just show you. Let's just pick this guy. This is sort of the printf, if you will, or the print statements of bacon. So we're getting a log statement after each stream kind of gets created. Right? And which one file is that? That was 3. That is 3. All right. So, where did I hook this up? Righto. So it's hooked up on the blur event, right? So it's not going to do anything until I lose focus. Actually, let's just change that right quick to key up. Perfect. All right, so I just added a J, right? That's all I did. And immediately you see that the first one returns an event, the second one pulls out the value, the third one says, does it match the regex? It's not correct. So there's that. So you can kind of do this console log, or this log, if you will, and plug it in between the streams, and you can kind of get an understanding of that. Bacon has some other stuff as well. Let's see. There's log. There's a descriptor one as well. I haven't used it yet. Sorry, I can't find, I don't know where it is in this doc off the top of my head. But it does have a couple of methods that allow it to say, I, as a stream, have these other streams hooked up into me. And these are their values. So there are methods kind of built into that to allow you to see what the graph of streams kind of looks like. So that's pretty helpful as well. Unfortunately, there's not really, when you're kind of putting things together, the only kind of place to put it in is between the mapping functions, where your debug points. It's not really a way to, I mean, if you want to look through the bacon source, you can step into it, but I wouldn't recommend
that.
Is
there an exception? Does it clearly say which mapping function is throwing that there?
No, but you can make a logic inside that, inside the event stream, rather. You can tell the event stream to do something when it, something particular happens.
Okay.
So the, each stream has an on value and an on error terminating function, if you will. That's where you normally sort of handle these, you know, where we're handing our assignments, what we're, when we're manipulating something. Those last terminating functions are where you want to do those. Anything else? Yes?
Is it better to start with just, if you're new to double paradigm, just start with functional first and then move on to functional reactive?
You know, I will say this. I will say if you can use functional libraries and sort of functional concepts, I think that is a great way, and that will help you regardless of whether you pick up FRP or not. I think having a functional toolkit in your or library in your toolkit, rather, is an excellent thing to have. I found that it just lets me think about things differently. There's some really cool functions like curry, for instance, like an Indian curry. It's called curry. So at curry, what it does, it just allows you to, let's say a function takes three parameters, right? What it allows you to do is build up a function which takes one parameter, returns another function which takes another parameter, and when it finally receives that third one, it'll actually go call your original function with those three parameters in it. What that sort of allows you to do is sort of build up this last layer, if you will, before that last terminating function, last terminating parameter, and share that intermediary function around. So you can reuse that little last bit and not have to make the same function calls over and over again everywhere rather. So functional library in general should help you write much more reusable code. And it's really great for manipulating data off of it. If you're doing any kind of event streams or event tracking, any kind of user tracking, advertising, anything to do with tracking in general, you should definitely look into any functional library, whatever they are. My recommendation would be Ramda, but preference, and because I mentioned the composition, the composability of functions in there. Yes?
Did you say Ramda?
Ramda, R-A-M-D-A.
Yeah.
Oh, here. I'll just, you can write it down. I had a slide here somewhere.
Is that just reactive lambda expressions? Is that why they named it that way?
No, it's just called Ramda. Lambda, but Ramda. I mean,
what does?
What's that, sir?
Just the coincidental.
I don't know.
Well, the
between Lambda.
The original functional programming is ultimately based on
Lambda calculus.
Lambda calculus,
right.
Which,
yeah.
Church and Turing realized or was equivalent to the Turing machine when they were inventing computer science back then.
Right. Yeah.
So.
There's actually going to be a Lambda calculus talk on the functional programming users group next month. So if you're interested in Lambda calculus, you should check out to that. So yeah, it's just called Ramda up there. Really good library, lots of utility stuff over there. They definitely have kind of veered into the pure functional side of things. They've got these things called lenses. I'm not going to explain what those are. But it's cool. It's useful. Like, you can take an entire data structure and say, hey, I want to zoom in, basically. That's what a lens is. I want to get to these nested attributes and do some operations with these nested attributes in this thing without having to explicitly iterate through the entire data structure myself. And so you kind of build these lenses that kind of give you a viewing capability inside this complicated data structure and do some work only on those particular attributes that you care about. So definitely takes a mind-bending twist on how to use some of that stuff, but can be useful.
Unless you slip a little query into your imperative programming. What was the second paradigm?
It's just imperative and functional. Oh, declarative programming. Yeah, so functional programming in general can be viewed as declarative programming because you don't ever specify how to do things, you just specify what to do. So even something as simple as calculating the sum on the list, you basically tell the compiler, whichever language you're using, hey, when I see an empty list, return 0. When I see one item and the rest of the list, take that one item, add it to my accumulator, and that's it. You don't specify all the internals. You don't specify the iteration. You don't specify the type. Most languages you don't have to. Most functional ones you don't have to. You just say, do these things when you see that. And kind of leave it up to the compiler, which is pretty awesome for code reusability. Lets you write less stuff. In dynamic languages, you don't have to worry so much. But because the type system isn't there, you can break a lot of things and not know it. So that's the only thing. If you have any questions after the fact or anything, feel free to ping me personally. That's perfectly fine. Or contact me in the meetup group, whatever you want. That's more or less all I had.
Awesome.
Can I have a little plug at the end? Is that okay if I
of
ask?
Of course.
So I've got a friend who's looking for a couple of Angular devs and also just senior JavaScript folks in general. So if you're interested in that, talk to me or email me. That's it.
Awesome. Well, thanks for the presentation. Appreciate you coming out.
No worries.
Apologies for everybody watching this on YouTube. We'll get the AV figured out. Now that we've done it once, we know. I was already looking up like what gear we need for the next run. But thank you guys for watching on YouTube. Thank you guys for attending in person.